vacuum interrupters used to leak. There was a phenomenon of outgassing or internal gassing, gases being generated. In layman's language, vacuum means nothing. But as engineers, we know it's not absolutely nothing. Still, there are 10 to 14 molecules per cm square. In the sense, the vacuum itself does not quench the arc, but rather it builds the dielectric strength, which is required to ensure that the arc does not ignite after current zero.
Hello everyone, and welcome to the Electrical Guy Power Panel. In this playlist, we will be having different industry experts talking about the crucial concepts in the electrical industry. They will be sharing their wealth of knowledge with all of us. And today is the first episode of PPP, or the Electrical Guy Power Panel. And today we have an honor to have with us Mr. Sandeep Kulkarni. Sandeep Kulkarni is coming up with a very rich experience of 23 years in the vacuum interruption technology. And I had a very, very interesting discussion with him on the vacuum interruption technology that we use. Now, the discussion that I had with him is divided into three different parts. In part one, we're talking about the history of vacuum interruption, how it evolved, and then how vacuum interruption works. That is the part one. In part two, we will be talking about why the medium voltage switchgear industry is completely dominated by the vacuum interruption technology. And we will also discuss some of the benefits of vacuum interruption technology. And Sandeep Kulkarni also shares with us some of his thoughts on the vacuum interruption now entering into the high voltage industry. And in the third part of this video, we will be discussing about what were the challenges in scaling up this vacuum interruption to a very high level, transmission level. And in the end, in the part three, Sandeep sir also talks about some of the key opportunities for all the young engineers out there in the vacuum interruption technology. So it's a super interesting discussion that I had. Personally, I've learned a lot of things while discussing with him, and I'm 100% sure that you will also be learning a lot of things via this discussions. So make sure you get your pen and paper ready, because in this part, the part one, we will be talking about the history of vacuum interruption and how vacuum interruption works. Now, Sandeep sir also just not tell us how it works, but he also shares the science behind it. So definitely do watch it till the end and enjoy this video. So hello everyone, welcome to the video. Today we have a pleasure, or rather I would say it's an honor to have Mr. Sandeep Kulkarni with us. So Sandeep sir is coming with a wealth of knowledge. He's been into the industry for more than 20 years. He worked in different departments like the testing department. He was part of the R&D team of vacuum interrupters. He headed the design and development of vacuum interrupters in India. He is also part of Seagray committee, represented India a lot of times. He has published more than 15 papers on the vacuum technology. And it's certainly an honor to have you here, sir. Welcome to the Power Panel. And I'm certainly very 100% sure that all the discussions that we are going to have today will definitely benefit all the students, all the audience of the channel. Thank you so much for being part of this panel.
Thanks, Gaurav. Thanks for having me on this Power Panel. It's indeed a nice name. And congratulations. This is a very nice initiative from your side, whereby you are publishing videos on various topics of electrical engineering. I love to watch your videos. I regularly do that. And definitely, these videos are of immense benefit to young engineers, students, and also experienced engineers like me. I also learn quite a lot through these videos. So keep it going on, and thanks for having me in this episode.
It's an honor, sir. So thank you so much for being here. So there are a lot of things we can talk with Sandeep sir on different topics. He's one of the experts that I've known. But today we will be talking about the vacuum interruption technology that is very frequently used in the medium voltage industry. And now it is also going into the high voltage industry. So certainly it's going to be a really, really interesting discussion with Sandeep sir. So let us start here with the first question that I have, sir, for you is, can you please tell us about a little bit of the history of vacuum interruption, how it started?
Okay. Nice question to start with and to set the context. So if I can ask you one question before I answer this. So can you guess how old would be the vacuum interrupter technology or the vacuum interrupter as a product? How old it would be? Any guess?
So I'll just do a wild guess here.
Yeah,
So
yeah.
maybe more than 50 years old.
Okay. I'm glad to say that this is the centenary year
Oh.
for the demonstration of the first vacuum interrupter. So the first vacuum interrupter was in fact demonstrated way back in 1924 by Professor Sorensen in the California Institute of Technology, or Caltech, as they call it in USA. So this is 2024. So we are indeed celebrating the 100 years of the demonstration of the vacuum interrupter technology. But of course, since 1924 was the year in which a practical switch was demonstrated, so obviously the research would have started way back, maybe 20, 30 years back. And obviously, the first patent actually for a vacuum switch, right now I will not call it as a vacuum interrupter, I'll call it as a vacuum switch. So the first patent for vacuum switch was filed way back in 1890, you could imagine. Even
Yeah.
before 1900, so 1890, the first patent was filed, and then on research took place, giving the birth to the first demonstration, we can call it, of the vacuum switch. That was in 1924, as I said, and that triggered a lot of research and development in many universities. And the switch, what Professor Sorensen demonstrated, was a simple glass tube evacuated, and with two electrodes which were separated to create the gap and to create the induction, or to create the switch, what we can say. It was nothing like the commercial vacuum interrupters what we see today. So after 1924, a lot of application research happened, how to convert this demonstration prototype into an actual working commercial product. So a lot of research happened on the vacuum arcs, how the arc evolves, how the arc has to be interrupted or extinguished. Then how this sealing has to be done, because the vacuum has to be maintained. It's not that we keep on continuously pumping the vacuum. So obviously we pump the vacuum and then it should be a sealed for life kind of a device. So a lot of research took place on the sealing technology. And based on these efforts in the field of sealing technology and also the arc interruption studies, we got the first commercial vacuum interrupter in mid-50s, in mid-1950s, in USA, those times. But even that was plagued with quite a number of problems, like sealing was still not completely mastered. Vacuum interrupters used to leak. There was a phenomenon of outgassing or internal gassing, gases being generated from the inside components of the vacuum interrupter. Then, current chopping. So there was a challenge of current chopping also. And one more problem was anticipated, which was cold welding, welding of contacts, okay, both under cold condition and also during arcing. So there were, of course, many challenges even after we got the first commercial product in mid-1950s. And over a period of 1.5 decades after that, based on a lot of developments and research, by 1965, by 1970, we can say that the vacuum interrupter was more or less stabilized as a device for current interruption in the medium voltage.
So up to
And once
52 KV we developed in 19, till
At that
1970.
time, it was 12 and 36 kV
Okay.
still. And when we are talking about the mid-70s, it was still 20, 12, 24, 36 kV kind of vacuum interrupters. And then by 75 or 80, we can say that vacuum interrupter was accepted and established as a product of choice for interruption of current in the medium voltage segment. There were, of course, SF6 breakers, oil circuit breakers, the MOCBs, the BOCBs, they were still there. So in those times, VCB was just starting to gain its share or starting to find its feet, what we can say, because bulk medium oil, minimum oil circuit breakers and SF6 circuit breakers were well established. So vacuum was still coming of age. But then in the next 10 years, it was kind of say no looking back for vacuum breakers. It became a game product changer. Of price. And then the share steadily went on rising from then onwards. Yeah, so that's history maybe from 1890s to 1980s for the vacuum interrupter and the vacuum circuit breaker.
Yeah, certainly. It's an interesting history to look back because there was, as you mentioned clearly, oil circuit breakers were also present. There was then air blast, SF6 were taking the market on. And then in those phase, this vacuum entered. And I think now if we look at the medium voltage, it is completely dominated by the vacuum technology. So that's a great insight, sir. Thanks for sharing that. So my next question to you is, now we have the SF6 technology, we had air, we had oil. How this vacuum technology differs from this, or how the vacuum interruption works, and how different it is from the currently available technology like SF6 interruption?
Okay. Again, I'll start with the question. Have you seen oil circuit breakers or SF6 circuit breakers? SF6 you might have seen.
Yeah, oil. SF6 I've seen. Oil only in the pictures, not in the reality.
Okay. So vacuum breaker differs quite a lot with respect to an oil or SF6 circuit breakers. I had the fortune of seeing one of the last generations of oil circuit breakers, I can say. When I started my job, oil circuit breakers were more or less extinct by that time. I'm talking about 2001, 2003 kind of time period. And they were already losing the ground. They had already lost the ground. They were in the last steps of being obsolete. But I had the fortune to see a few oil circuit breakers in service. So, vacuum circuit breakers differ quite a lot as compared to the SF6 and the oil circuit breakers. So, now we talk about two words here, vacuum interrupters and vacuum circuit breakers. Whereas when we talk about SF6 or oil, we do not have a separate entity as an interrupter. The interrupter is more or less built into the breaker when we say call a vacuum, when you say an oil or an SF6 breaker. Whereas, we all know for vacuum breakers, the interrupter is a separate entity, it's a separate brick. It can be replaced more easily. So it exists independently as compared to a breaker. Whereas in SF6 or an oil, it's an integrated part or a pole of the breaker itself. So the interrupter, vacuum interrupter, is the current interruption chamber where the contacts separate, where the arc evolves, where the arc is extinguished. And as the arc is extinguished, we say that the current is interrupted. So that's why this is called as a vacuum interrupter, because the interruption of current happens inside the medium is vacuum.
Vacuum.
Yeah. So this is where the first difference starts. In SF6 or air blast breakers, there's a positive pressure of either SF6 or air. And in case of oil, there's obviously oil in the liquid form. Mm. Whereas in case of a vacuum interrupter, it's actually devoid of medium. When we say vacuum, in layman's language, vacuum means nothing. But as engineers, we know, it's not absolutely nothing. Still, there are 10 raised to 14 molecules per cm square. If we go by that Avogadro's number, that philosophy, still there are plenty of molecules present even when we talk about 10 raised to minus 6 torr, which is the pressure at which generally the vacuum interrupter operates. So here, vacuum is being used as a dielectric medium more than as an interruption medium. In case of SF6 gas or oil, I'll take the example of SF6 gas because many of the today's engineers still would have seen SF6, would have learned SF6. So how current interruption happens in SF6 is the arc is bombarded with high velocity SF6 gas. And the role of SF6 gas is to, first of all, flush out all the electrons, because we know SF6 is an electronegative gas. So it absorbs takes away all the electrons from the arc. Secondly, it cools the arc because SF6 gas has a good thermal conductivity. So it cools the arc. And when we know that any medium is devoid of electrons, it becomes even more difficult for the current to exist. That is the arc to exist. And when we again pull down the arc, the conductivity of arc would decrease, the resistance would increase, and again create a more conducive environment for arc interruption. So this is how SF6 work, and I call it as an active form of working. Whereas vacuum interrupters are more passive, in the sense the vacuum itself does not quench the arc, but rather it builds the dielectric strength which is required to ensure that the arc does not ignite after current zero. Okay. But to do that, there are certain preconditions that the temperature of the contacts should be below a certain threshold. Also, the metal vapor which is inside the vacuum interrupter should not be above a certain threshold. We call it the metal vapor density. So these two thresholds once met, that is, the temperature is below a certain threshold of the contacts and the metal vapor density inside the interrupter is not above a certain threshold. If these thresholds are met, then there are the situation is very much conducive for creating an environment that the vacuum as a background medium ensures that the arc does not ignite after the first current zero or the second current zero. Now, how to ensure these two thresholds? So as I said, we need to keep the contact temperature below a certain value. Now, why does the contact temperature increase? Now, I'm going in the backward direction. I'm starting from current zero and going how the arc is generated inside.
Okay. Yeah.
So we know that any switch, for that matter, it's a mechanical switch. When you separate the contacts, there will be an arc. No matter how small or how tiny the arc is. Even a tube light switch at our home, if it's an inductive tube light, not today's LED tube lights, but in the olden days, there used to be inductive chokes. So there used to be a lag of current because of Lenz's law, and still the current used to persist and we could see a tiny spark behind the switch. So current tries to exist. It tries to oppose the interruption. So the moment we mechanically separate the two contacts, the current does not die out at that moment. It stays. Okay, that's the very nature of the current, and that's why you and me have jobs, isn't it? If current would have died out instantly, switchgear engineers wouldn't have had any job. There wouldn't be any circuit breakers or interrupters, no Gaurav or no Sandeep required.
Correct.
Okay, jokes apart, coming to the crux of the matter. So when the pack separate, the current tries to maintain itself and in the form of arc, and intensity of the arc depends upon the value of current. So if it's a fault current, like say 20 ampere or 40 ampere, the intensity would be obviously much more as compared to a rated current extinction, say 1600 ampere, 2000 ampere. And this arc can exist in various forms that I will come to. But the moment the contacts are separated, an arc is formed. Initially, when the contacts are a short distance apart, the arc is spread out, more like water coming out from a shower with a lot of paths. So the arc is well spread out. But after a certain threshold of the value of current, because as we know, current is sinusoidal, so it is rising, and above a certain threshold, this shower nature of the arc, what we call as a diffuse nature, it gives way to another form of arc, what we call as a constricted arc. Constricted arc is like a candle or a stick or like a cylinder having a smaller diameter. Okay, so this constricted arc is formed after a certain threshold, and this constricted arc creates an increase in temperature of the contacts. So as I said, we need to keep the temperature of the contacts below a certain threshold. So from where does this temperature come? This arc. The arc is responsible for raising the temperature of the contacts, because arc is nothing but plasma, high temperature plasma composed of electrons, ions, metal vapors. Okay, so it's a composition of all this, and it's extremely high temperature. It can easily vaporize, not even melt, but vaporize copper and chromium, which are the elements present inside the contacts. So this arc, which is now in the form of a cylinder, increases the metal temperature, which causes the evaporation of the metal from the contacts. And this is all happening where the current is still there. Okay, the current is still flowing. And now the current zero is approaching. Okay, and the current zero is approaching. And as we know, at current zero, there is a phenomenon of called as RRRV, rate of rise of recovery. The moment we approach a current zero, there's a current zero pause, as we call. It's for a very short duration of few nanoseconds, but there's a pause in the value of current. And the moment it happens, the rate of rise of recovery voltage kicks in. And then there's a race, the famous race between rate of rise of recovery voltage and rate of rise of dielectric strength. The one who wins the race decides what is going to happen the next. For us, the switchgear designers or electrical engineers, the task is to help the rate of rise of dielectric strength to win the race and not the RRRV. So as to ensure that the current is interrupted at the first current zero, if not at the first, at least the second current zero. So as I said, the contacts are being heated by this arc. So we need to reduce the temperature. Okay. So there are two ways of reducing this temperature. One way is to not the arc being constricted. As I said, initially the arc is in the form of a shower with a lot of parallel paths. And as we know, if there are a lot of parallel paths, the current density is lower, isn't it?
Correct.
So current is more uniformly distributed and so is the heat. But once the arc becomes constricted like a cylindrical, so the current density is very high because now the current is concentrated on a very small area of the contact. So why can't we keep the arc in the diffused or in the shower mode? That will be the first obvious question. Yes, we can do that. And that is one of the ways to reduce the heat load or the joule input to the contact surface. And that technology is called as the axial magnetic field technology, where we apply an axially oriented magnetic field to keep the arc in the diffused mode.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Alternately, we allow the arc to be in the constricted mode, that is in the cylindrical mode. We accept, okay, if you want to be in the cylindrical mode, no problem. We let you be. But then we will not allow you to position yourself at any single location. We will continuously move the arc. Now, you imagine there's a candle and there's a flame of the candle. And if you keep your finger in that flame, obviously you'll get hurt. Your finger will sense the temperature. But if you move your finger very fast through that flame, you may not feel it. Or you would have seen people walking on the coal beds, burning coal beds. If you walk very fast, your feet would not feel the heat. So same philosophy we are using here. What we do is we move the arc very fast. So once you move the arc fast, so it's the reverse. In that case, the candle flame is stationary, you move your finger. In this case, the contact is stationary and we move the arc on the contact surface. So contact does not then feel the heat the same extent as it would have felt if the arc would have been stationary. Because now different positions of the contacts are getting heated. And the speed of rotation is so fine-tuned that it should not be too fast. If it's too fast, then the arc will come back at the same location in a very short time. So we will lose that advantage of not letting it get overheated. If it's too slow, the arc will stay at any particular location for a very long time. So the designers of this contact design the contact in such a way that the arc rotation speed is optimal, not too slow, not too fast. And how we rotate is we apply a magnetic field, which is called as a radially oriented magnetic field. And here we go back to our college days, Fleming's left-hand rule. You remember Fleming's left-hand rule?
Yeah.
So what does the Fleming's left-hand rule tell us?
I remember, it's difficult for me to...
Okay, fine. Okay. So even I don't remember the exact fingers what they point to, but we know it's a rule which tells us about the relationship between the current, the magnetic field and the force. Use it for understanding the rotation of the motor. So we use the same rule here. So there's a current, okay, which is flowing in the form of an arc. And there's a contact, and we design the contact in such a way that the magnetic field which is getting generated by the flow of current is perpendicular to the flow of current. So if magnetic field and current are perpendicular, then the third direction, if one is X, second is Y, then the Z direction would be the force.
Force.
Which is acting on this conductor. Because we know any current carrying conductor placed in a magnetic field experiences a force. This is how the motor rotates. So this is how the arc rotates. We use this principle or this phenomenon to rotate the arc. The arc is carrying the current, so it's a conductor. And the current itself creates the magnetic field through specifically designed contacts. This magnetic field interacts with the current and what we call as the J cross B force, JB sine theta, in vector terms. So that JB sine theta is the J cross B sine theta is the force which gets generated. And this force is a circumferential force, which makes the arc to rotate. So the current is axial, the magnetic field is radial, and the force is circumferential. So under the influence of the circumferential force, the arc rotates. And as the arc rotates, as I said, the heat input to the contacts reduces. This ensures that the temperature is kept under check. And the generation of the metal vapor also reduces. So the two conditions which are required, reduction in the temperature of the contacts and reduction in the metal vapor. As I said during the start, that these are the two thresholds what we need for creating conditions which are conducive for ensuring that the RRRV does not win the race. And then the rest, the vacuum takes care, because we know vacuum is a medium which is having very less number of particles as compared to normal atmospheric pressure. And once we have less number of particles, then there's a concept called mean free path. The distance between the two collisions is increased. The mean free path is increased. So the probability of collision decreases. And as the probability of collision decreases, we say that this results in a high dielectric strength of that medium. So this is how the vacuum plays a role. It creates a high dielectric strength atmosphere or a medium around the contacts, which have done their job of ensuring a low threshold of contact temperature and low threshold of the metal vapor. And why the contacts have to be at a lower temperature? Metal vapor, we understand, if metal vapor is there, it will form a conducting channel, okay, correct, isn't it? And then the current will easily flow through this metal vapor. But why do we also need the temperature to be at a low level? The reason is what we know as thermionic emissions. So we know that metals can emit electrons when heated. But there is again a threshold. If the temperature is below a certain value, then this thermionic emission does not happen. So that's why we need to keep the temperature of the contacts below a certain threshold. Otherwise, even if there's no metal vapor, the superheated contacts will start emitting electrons in that case. And that's why these two thresholds are met by designing the contacts. And the vacuum as a medium ensures that the RRDS wins the race against RRRV, and there's the current gets interrupted. So this is how, in a nutshell, a vacuum interrupter works.
Clear. I think when we say the SF6 interruption, it is because the SF6 gas takes out all the available free electrons from the interrupter part. But yes, when we open the contacts in the vacuum, so since anyways there is no free electrons present, does it also helps in breaking the current?
No. The current interruption solely depends upon the contacts and also depends upon the metal vapor. So at that moment, till current zero, vacuum is not playing any actual role in the current interruption. The role of vacuum starts only after current zero. So till current zero, the entire phenomenon of generation of metal vapor is guided by the sinusoidal increase in current, and it depends upon the contact metallurgy. And also surrounding, there are some surrounding elements like contact shields or vapor condensing shields. So these are the elements which play a critical role in deciding what is happening till current zero. Okay. And after current zero, then it's the role of the vacuum medium which takes over.
Okay. And I think that's why you rightly mentioned in the beginning of this question that vacuum is a dielectric medium rather than it's an interrupting medium.
Yes.
I think that's a very interesting statement and also very important statement. And definitely, it's a very interesting technology that you explained. And the way you explained, I think it made it very, very simple for us to understand. At least I learned a lot of things from that question. So thank you so much for that detailed answer on how vacuum interruption works. So
just if I can add here, because I talked about vacuum interrupter, but we also need to know something about the vacuum breaker, how the interrupter coordinates with the vacuum breaker, because not many of us would see a vacuum interrupter in the field. We would see a vacuum breaker, isn't it?
Yeah.
So I'll touch upon how the vacuum interrupter interacts with a vacuum circuit breaker. So as I said, it's a mechanical separation of contacts takes place. There's a fixed contact and there's a moving contact inside a vacuum interrupter. So the moving contact is actually coupled to the mechanism of the breaker through a lot of linkages, which I'll not touch upon right now. But there are a lot of linkages through which the moving contact is connected to the breaker mechanism. And there are certain bands of opening speeds which need to be maintained to open the contacts or to move the moving contact away from the fixed contact, which ensures that the current is interrupted. So that's how the breaker and the interrupter are coupled to each other. Not only the mechanism, but the breaker also provides the mechanical support or the mechanical housing to the vacuum interrupter. It also provides the current carrying path, because vacuum interrupter is just a cylinder. There has to be current carrying path which connects the external world to the vacuum interrupter. So this current carrying path is also provided by the vacuum circuit breaker. So I thought I should touch upon how interrupter and breaker are related to each other.
Yeah, sure. Because that is important when we talk about medium voltage. As you mentioned, we have dedicated bottles of vacuum interruption. So yes, how it is connected, how it is interlinked, I think it's a valid point that you mentioned. Thank you for that. So ultimately, what we have to remember is, in any sort of interruption, if your dielectric strength recovery rate is higher than that of the rate of rise of recovery voltage, the current interruption is possible. And that's how it happens in vacuum interruption also. So thank you, sir, for that detailed answer. I think it will solve a lot of confusion that people had in their mind. Thank you so much for that. And certainly after hearing all of this, I'm really interested in knowing more details on this. So if you can share us, if there are, let's say, if I want to know more about this, there are some conferences that happens or some events related to the vacuum interruption. Can I attend this or how to go into that? Any details you have on that?
Sure, Gaurav. And I'm happy that this discussion has kindled in you to look for more literature on vacuum interrupters. And I hope the listeners also would be interested to know more about this technology. So yes, there are quite a lot of books which you can refer to on vacuum interrupters. And there are conferences happening world over related to this field. If we talk about IEEE, then there's a dedicated transactions called as IEEE Transactions on Plasma Science. Okay, many of the papers which appear in this journal are related to current interruption in vacuum. So there is IEEE Transactions on Dielectric and Insulation System, DEIS, what we call it. So that is more towards the insulation performance of the vacuum as compared to the interruption performance. So these two basic IEEE journals can give you a lot of knowledge on current interruption in vacuum, and also how vacuum as an insulator or as a dielectric is playing a role in this current interruption. And talking about conferences, one conference which comes to my mind, at the top of my mind, because it's a premier conference in this field, it's called ISDEIV. Okay, I'll give this full form. ISDEIV stands for International Symposium on Discharges and Electrical Insulation in Vacuum. Okay, I'll repeat it. ISDEIV, International Symposium on Discharges and Electrical Insulation in Vacuum. So it deals with a wide range of subjects. As the title suggests, discharges in vacuum and insulation in vacuum. But this conference is not confined to vacuum interrupters alone, because there are a lot of applications of discharges and electrical insulation in vacuum. X-ray tubes are a perfect example where vacuum is used as an insulating medium. Particle accelerators, plasma research, fusion, space research. So there are a lot of applications, thin film depositions, where we have vacuum, where we have discharges, and where we have insulation. But since we are talking about vacuum interrupters as a subject today, I would definitely say that this is a premier conference for researchers or industry experts or students who would like to know more upon the vacuum interrupter as a subject. So you can Google it, ISDIV, you can get the link to this conference. And it happens every 2 years. It started way back in 1962 or 64 in USA. And after that, it has been happening every 2 years in a different country. In 2014, I was fortunate enough to be part of a committee which organized this conference in India. That was the first time this conference was organized in India. We had it in Mumbai. I personally started attending this conference since 2008, when it was held in Romania. And since then, I have been attending almost all the editions of this. And the last one was in Okinawa, Japan, where I attended. And next one is going to be in China in 2025. So the call for papers is still open. So if anyone of you are interested to publish the paper, the abstract submission date, I think, is around end of January. And the conference would be happening in September in Sichuan University in China. So students or researchers who would like to submit the papers or contribute to this conference or even attend this conference, you can take a note of that. And Gaurav, I'm sure you'll definitely share in the video the link to this presentation. So you can take advantage of that. And definitely, if this talk has kindled in you some interest in the field of vacuum interrupters or how interruption happens in vacuum, do not miss to attend this conference. And for any queries regarding this conference, I'm open to answer those queries because I am on the permanent committee of this conference. So there's a permanent committee which governs this conference, and glad to share that I'm one of the members in the permanent committee. So I'll be happy to answer any queries or support you in terms of publishing the papers or attending the conference. So hope it answers your question, Gaurav.
Yeah, definitely. I'm looking forward for this conference that is soon going to happen in 2025 in China. And definitely, as you mentioned, we'll put links for those down in the description so you can go and check it out. How is this conference? What are the details of that? Will be available. And if you want to present any sort of paper or anything, we'll also be providing an email ID in the description where you can reach out for some of the queries, and sir is there for us to help because he is one of the permanent committee member of that. And I think that's a golden opportunity for you also to interact with him. So definitely take the full advantage of this opportunity.
Thanks, Gaurav.
So that's the end of part one. Now we discussed about how the vacuum technology evolved throughout the years and how the vacuum interruption technology works. So we talked about that famous race between the rate of rise of recovery voltage and the rate of rise of dielectric strength. So we have to make sure that the rate of rise of recovery voltage win the race and not the RRRV. And that's how the interruption can be possible. And in the end, Sandeep sir also shared with us some of the key conferences that you must attend in case if you're interested in the vacuum interruption technology. If you want to publish your papers, then that detail is also available there. And all those links are provided down in the description. You can go and check it out. And if you have any questions on today's discussion, definitely put your questions in the comment section below. We'll select some of the question and we will answer it for you, all of you guys. Part 2 of this video gets more interesting because in part 2, we are going to discuss about why the medium voltage industry is fully dominated by the vacuum interruption. And Sandeep sir also shares some of his thoughts about the vacuum technology now entering into the transmission world. So we are seeing now the high and extra high voltage circuit breakers coming up with the vacuum interruption technology. That detail you'll get in the next episode of this discussion. And for which you must subscribe to the channel because that's how you will be getting the updates with bell notification icon turned on. If that video is already available, then I'll put that link for that video down in the description, which you can check it out. Thank you so much for watching. I hope you found it useful. If you did, then of course do like the video and do share it with the people you think might be interested in knowing about the vacuum interruption technology. Thank you for watching, guys. I'll see you in my next one, but till then, keep watching, keep learning.